confident. Live from Bloomington, Indiana.
From the Ashton Door.
From Ashton Stemple Hall, it's the Hoosier Hipsteria Podcast, episode Oceans 11.
Look at how loud this volume bar is.
It was a great intro.
It was worthy of applause.
Don't clap.
I'm gonna ruin it.
Don't cry for me either.
Pardon.
Some interesting things have happened in this week in sports history. As always,
something interesting has to happen because
something deviant happens usually in a given week, especially if a guy like Metta World Peace is playing basketball.
If Metta World Peace channels dinner on our heads.
In case you didn't notice, we're just getting right into it.
Yeah.
Not even telling you what's coming up.
Because it's the biggest news in the whole world.
Yes.
It's really not.
So, Josh, I don't remember which night it was because I'm a poor researcher.
You are a poor researcher.
But Metta World Peace, being Ron Artest, he gave James Harden his peaceful elbow.
Pretty bad concussion.
And he gave him the peaceful elbow.
Gave him the people's elbow.
And
Ouchtown population.
Yeah, and it gave James Harden a concussion. And Ron Artest is suspended for 7 games, and sports media is losing their mind over this story. Do you think it's worth all the hype that it's receiving?
Well, my first thoughts on it are that I don't think I've yet seen a major sports personality voice the opinion that he was not intending to elbow Harden in the head. I think that that was an accident. Personally, just looking at the way what he's doing, it just seems like it was a very exuberant celebration. But my problem with it was that after he elbowed Harden and knocked him to the ground, he kept jumping around and pounding his chest and stuff. And I don't want to sound like I'm making excuses for the guy, but I think that could easily be explained by he just didn't realize that he hit him. Although that is a little hard to defend because if you connect your elbow on someone's head, you're generally going to know that your elbow is going to hurt a lot. But I think people really want Ron Artest to be Ron Artest again, and this is like a doorway, and they're trying to shove their foot through the door. I just don't think that it's that big of a deal, though. I don't think it means he's going to go into the stands and beat up a fan tomorrow or anything. I just don't think it's that big of a deal.
Well, like you said, I don't believe it's 100% a deliberate act. And along with what you were saying about him not realizing what he did when it happened, that happens a lot in sports. If you talk to a running back or something, any football player, you'll notice they say something like, well, I didn't even realize what I had done until after the game when I watched it and thought about it. A lot of sports, you're just fueled on so much adrenaline during the game that you don't realize what's going on until afterwards. So there's a legitimate case to be made that Ron Artest didn't actually know that he hit James Harden as hard as he did. And that's a celebration even the part where he cocks in and brings the elbow out, that's a thing people do in sports all the time. Watch a defensive lineman celebrate after a sack and put James Harden's face in the way. That's worse than what Ron Artest did. But the thing that bothers me about it most is that the past 6 years of Ron Artest's career have been a story in and of itself of him turning himself around since the brawl. And it bothers me that people are going to look past the fact that he won the J. Walter Kennedy Citizenship Award in 2011. That he has cleaned up his act as far as being a violent person. He's very personal with his fans in a social media presence. He's one of the most interactive guys to follow on Twitter.
He's one of the funniest guys to follow.
He's one of the best guys to follow on Twitter. He sold his 2010 ring, his title ring, on eBay and donated the profits to charity. I think mental health
Yeah.
Was what it was. I don't know. To me, he just seems like, and this is going to be after the fact, after he retires in a few years after, he's going to be the most misunderstood guy the NBA has ever seen.
I completely agree.
Akin to what Ricky Williams was. There's totally going to be a documentary or two made about Ron Artest.
Yeah.
And his career in the NBA. Also, he had a rebuttal of his own while he was on Twitter. After this episode of I think today or yesterday's episode of ESPN First Take, with I think Magic Johnson, Stephen A. Smith, Skip Bayless, the usual guys.
Yeah.
He said he kept pointing out to people saying that the media doesn't cover other players' violence as much as Ron Artest. He specifically called out Shaquille O'Neal for those times that he elbowed so and so in the face and threw a punch at someone else.
Yeah.
I mean, there's plenty of incidents of other players in the NBA that aren't as big of a deal as what Ron Artest is up to lately. So I guess it kind of bothers me that he's the scapegoat for violence in the NBA.
Exactly.
When really it's a lot of people freaking out and you know, losing control during a basketball game.
I mean, you watch Dwight Howard in the post, and he is all elbows. He just flails around in there. And granted, that's after a rebound, but I remember he almost put Roy Hibbert in. I think he did put Roy Hibbert in the hospital. I don't know. I'm not sure if that's true or not. But I remember him doing that to someone, hitting them hard enough that he, like, knocked him out or something, and they had to go to the hospital to get a CAT scan or a MRI. I don't know hospital terms. But my point is that the NBA is a very violent sport. And it's obviously a little different because he was doing it in a celebration and not getting a rebound. But I agree with what you were saying, that he is like the scapegoat because of his past history. And I don't think there's any real argument that he has turned it around. He's completely different than he was on the Pacers. And keep in mind that these are two... We've been Pacers fans since we started watching the NBA, is that right?
Right, or late 90s.
And he single-handedly... brought forth the demise of the Pacers. I mean, they've rebuilt it, but still, that he went into the stands and ruined the Pacers for 5 years at least.
He ruined their greatest shot at getting an
exactly.
NBA title.
And we're still defending him, which I think that shows something. I think that shows that he has turned it around, and it is... I don't know. I'm having a lot of trouble putting my thoughts into words.
I just, like, it's one of those things where I don't like what he did for the Pacers. And then he lost his cool, completely lost his cool. But I do want him to be a better person. And I want him to, like, turn it around. And eventually, I was happy when he won that NBA ring. And then I was even happier when he decided that he was going to give up what may be his only NBA ring ever.
Yeah.
To a fan for charitable purposes. I don't know. I think he's a good guy. I'm not buying the hype that he is completely just full of malice.
Yeah.
And I don't think anyone else should either, because it's simply not true.
Yeah.
All right, now that we got that very important, more important than it should be, news out of the way, let's move on to tomorrow's main event, and I'm not talking about the end of the NBA regular season where Kobe Bryant might have a chance to beat Kevin Durant.
That would be so sad.
That would be sad, too. I'm talking, of course, about day one of the NFL draft, rounds 1 and 2.
The greatest happening in sports.
Josh, are you going to watch it?
Yeah, probably, but I'm also writing a paper at that time, so it's going to be... If I didn't have a paper, I'd be all over that, because I love the NFL draft for some reason. Even though it's pretty easy to just not watch it and then look at the results the next day, but I just love it for some reason. I don't know. I'm interested to see. I just love seeing, like, surprise picks as they happen. What about you?
I like surprise picks. I like the teams jumping up many spots to grab certain players. I like the potential that there's a lot of buzz going around in the at the draft tables. It's just kind of a cool environment. It's a very hustled environment, even though they get like 12 minutes for those first picks.
Yeah.
And there's potential that the first 3 to 4 picks are already decided, what with the Colts already selecting Andrew Luck.
And the Redskins has to be crazy.
And the Redskins, and the Redskins are more than likely going to grab Robert Griffin III. There's your first two guys right off the board. But yeah, I'm excited. I'm going to watch it for as long as I can. I'll watch it Thursday. I'll probably watch it Friday.
Yeah,
I don't know if I'll watch it. Is it 2 days or 3 day event?
I think it's... I don't know. I know they've changed it recently.
I probably won't watch the third day.
I think it's a 3 day event. I think the first two rounds are tomorrow, and then like 3, 4 are the next day, and then 5, 6, 7 are the next day or something. I'm not sure though.
Yeah, I probably won't.
The last day is usually just look at the paper to see if any notable.
I know that the Colts get 9 picks, including the first pick in the first round, and then they trade rounds from there on out with the St. Louis Rams. But what about the Steelers? What do you think the positions they really need to address in this draft? Positions that they probably need to count on more for the early rounds than going out into free agency and getting another guy.
Well, the Steelers are typically not real big free agent spenders. They generally build through the draft. Common perception is that they're going to take. Help me out with the guys, the Alabama player. I mix all the Alabama players.
Is it Dante Hightower?
Dante Hightower. Common perception is that they're going to take him with their first round. He's a linebacker from Alabama. I would really like that pick because they're replacing James Ferrier, who, I don't know if he retired or what. He's not on the team anymore, though. I think that actually they cut him.
He's very old.
Yeah. The thing about the Steelers is they're such an old team. They need help at pretty much every position. But they generally build through the linebackers core. They have guys like, Lamar Wedley. I completely blanked on his name. And Lawrence Timmons and James Harrison, obviously. But all those guys are getting up there in age. I would wager a lot of money. I wouldn't wager a lot of money. I would bet, though, that they're going to take a linebacker in the first round and then an offensive lineman in the second round. Who are they going to take? I don't know. But that would be my guess for the positions they would go after for the first couple rounds. Then they're going to probably take some guys for the defensive backfield, probably some defensive linemen here and there. But their focus is defense and getting their defense younger because they have a core group of guys on the offense other than offensive linemen who are pretty solid. But that's what I would say.
Yeah, I don't. I know that they're probably keen on getting Alabama players.
Definitely, because they fit that system perfectly.
They fit the system very well. The same reason I like that Chuck Pagano is the head coach of the Colts. There's an increased chance of Alabama getting their first, or the Colts getting their first Alabama player since I've been following either team. And I'm very excited at the prospect of that, simply because I think Chuck Pagano's, he drools over those Alabama players because they're playing in and actually the best 3-4 defense in history, one could say.
Yeah, definitely
those,
very arguable.
Those guys have played in one of the best systems, and Nick Saban knows how to run. Well, let me rephrase that. Kirby Smart knows how to run a 3-4 defense very well.
It's such a pro-style system already, so they're the best bet, obviously, to transition to the NFL.
Yeah, I think, the Colts have a lot of positions that they need to address, and that's because they've gotten rid of everyone.
Yeah.
Obviously, the quarterback position will be addressed. That's a guarantee. With the first overall pick, getting the best quarterback a draft has seen in a while, and that's Andrew Luck. The two positions they need to focus on after that, tight end and center. I don't think there's two pieces that could be more important to a young quarterback than having a guy grow up with a center that he's going to be playing with for almost his entire career, as well as a good tight end. And those need to be, I think those positions need to be addressed in the first three rounds. After that, especially when you have a guy like Bruce Arians being your offensive coordinator, you want talent so he doesn't have to build it.
Yeah, because Bruce Arians is really not going to take a bad offense and make it better.
No, but Chuck Pagano can take a bad defense and make it great, and that's why I think in the later rounds they address some of the defensive needs that they have. Defensive end, an outside linebacker that's played in the 3-4 defense, a cornerback, or some cornerbacks, because they don't really have any nominal quarterbacks outside of Jerrod Powers. A kick returner, that's really subjective on whether the NFL decides to keep kick returns in the game. But special teams are super important, a lot more important than the Colts have ever made them.
Yeah.
Because they always get messed up on those. And it's detrimental to the game. Also, probably they need to look at a fullback. They haven't used a fullback since Peyton Manning. They haven't really needed a fullback.
Because their offensive line is
just
so
good. They're going to change their system under Bruce Arians and Chuck Pagano. So they need to change. Well, they need to actually get a fullback. They don't have one. And, they just need to really address that fullback position. It doesn't need to be an early pick by any means because the fullback never is. Still a late round pick.
I want to see a fullback be taken first overall. Not by the Colts this year, but sometime in my lifetime.
Why would you want that?
Because it'd just be fun.
That position.
Just a team like the Warriors.
That position is totally fading
like
out.
Like the Golden State Warriors of the NFL, who
so
I guess the Raiders.
Yeah, the Raiders.
Which could probably do that, but I don't know. I think it'd be really funny.
But yeah, the wide receiver position is something they might want to address. I think they should address it in free agency.
Yeah.
And figure that out because at the moment, I think the only wide receivers they have are Austin Collie and Reggie Wayne.
Is Austin Collie still on the team? Didn't they just sign? That was the Broncos who signed Stokely.
Yeah, they didn't sign Stokely. They cut Blair White. They released Pierre Garçon. Left. I don't know how healthy Anthony Gonzalez is, but if he's healthy, he's a good asset.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I just know that they don't have a lot of wide receivers. They need a backup quarterback pretty bad. That isn't
too soon for Curtis Painter.
I don't know. It's a mess.
It's going to be... I think wide receiver should be something... definitely not in the first... Like,
wideout's one of the stronger positions in the draft.
Yeah. There's going to be a lot of talent. Maybe get one of those guys from Baylor. I don't know. I don't know any of their names.
Wright will go in.
I know. But some like the second, third, fourth tier Baylor wide receivers. Because they had great wide receivers. They shouldn't get anybody from Stanford because they're all terrible. But it's really... how important do you think it is for Andrew Luck to have a go-to wide receiver? Do you think he can...
I think it's more important for a younger quarterback to have a go-to tight end than a go-to wide receiver.
Yeah, that's a good point. Sort of like a safety
net. Yeah, you need that safety net. And also having a good receiving running back. I know just from watching Alabama football that most often the quarterback goes to his safety net, which it's just a great fail-safe to have, especially if you have a guy that can execute it really well. And young quarterbacks are going to make mistakes, and if you have a safety valve for them to go to, that's going to limit the mistakes by quite a bit. So I think it's very important, and Austin Collie's a great go-to wide receiver.
Yeah.
He's great at just catching. Like he doesn't make much after the play, but he's fantastic at catching. I don't know. I think he's got a couple good receivers in there. Obviously,
Reggie Wayne stayed, yeah.
And they want to start over as fresh as possible. So I think Andrew Luck needs to decide who his go-to wide receiver is rather than the Colts doing it for him.
That's a good point.
Another thing that's worth mentioning in this particular NFL draft is something that we in the South like to call the Nick Saban effect. And the Nick Saban effect is this... Well, it's this phenomenon where all of Alabama's draft-worthy players that have gone on to have pretty successful professional careers have all come out of the Nick Saban era of Alabama football. It's shocking how many good players are now starting in the NFL. Because of Nick Saban. And obviously you look at guys like, Kareem Jackson, John Parker Wilson, all these lower tier guys that don't really do, Javier Arenas, all these guys that don't do very much. Those are all from the Mike Shula era. They all were recruited by Mike Shula, and granted, Javier Arenas was a total dime in the rough and is now the go-to kick returner for the Kansas City Chiefs. I'm talking more about guys like Rolando McClain, Terrence Cody, Julio Jones, guys that Nick Saban recruited and are now starting in the NFL.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of potential to see five more guys go in the first round, meaning they're more than likely going to be starting in the NFL. Obviously, probably the highest pick an Alabama player will have is Trent Richardson, who could go as high as fourth, could go fifth. I mean, there's not enough that you can say about this guy to accurately describe what kind of running back he can be.
So strong.
He's too strong. He averages 5.8 yards a carry. He had 35 touchdowns on his career in 3 years. He's the only running back to, I think he's the only running back to have a 21 touchdown season, 20 touchdown season, other than in the SEC, other than maybe Herschel Walker. He's one of the three SEC players to have 20 rushing touchdowns in a season. Okay, that's what I meant.
Yeah,
and the
really
other
good.
Two are Tim Tebow and Cam Newton.
Tim Tebow.
And he's the 2011 Doak Walker winner, Heisman Maxwell, Walter Camp finalist, All-American. He lost one fumble and 614 career touches. He
ball security is job security.
He has another invaluable asset. He's better later in the game. 59.3% of his yards come after the first half. So he can be that fourth quarter.
Yeah,
go-to that you need to keep that clock moving. He ran a 4.440 at Alabama's pro day. He couldn't participate in the combine because of a knee surgery that he had. My favorite stat of Trent Richardson that's going to be invaluable in the NFL. He had 3,130 yards on his season. 49.7% of those yards came after contact.
He is a strong fellow.
He's very strong.
He's very fast.
He can bench 475 like it's almost nothing. It'll be really impressive to see his his reps.
Yeah, definitely.
During the
250 they do?
Yeah. And to see how many
he's
times
he's gonna like 90.
To see how many times he's gonna do that. It's gonna be way too impressive.
He honestly would probably break the record for most reps by running.
He could.
I wouldn't be surprised.
He could. He wants to, and that's his goal,
is
to break the reps.
My favorite is there's a video that surfaced of him recently of him just like in the front yard of one of his friends' house or something, and I think five of his friends just trying to take him down. They cannot do it. It's five grown men trying to tackle him to the ground, and he's just like stays up like it's nothing. It's unbelievable how strong the guy is.
Yeah, and he has a very... What I like about him the most is, he didn't win the Heisman, granted, but you can't really jump ahead of a player like Robert Griffin, especially when you can't even win your own division or your own region. Andrew Luck took the South region. But his unprecedented combination of size and speed is something that I haven't seen in a long time. And from the from his freshman year when he made that 57-yard run against Arkansas where he broke six tackles, you were like, yeah, this guy is absolutely going to go to the NFL. He's an NFL running back. So I'm excited. I wish him the best of luck wherever he goes. It's looking like he'll probably end up in Cleveland or Tampa Bay unless this new developing rumor that the New York Jets are going to trade up to probably get him.
How would you feel about that?
He's on a team with a bunch of SEC guys now. His old quarterback, Greg McElroy, Tim Tebow, whatever.
I always forget Tim Tebow plays with the Jets.
Yep. It's weird, but we manage it. Other guys that I'm just going to touch on for a little bit, the hard-hitting safety out of Mark Bear in a late early to mid first round pick should be a great asset for whatever team he goes to. Two-time first team All-American, two-time All-SEC, Thorpe finalist. He had 12 career picks, which is tied for eighth in Alabama history. Drake Kirkpatrick, granted he got in a little bit of trouble with marijuana possession, I guess. He's a lockdown cornerback, first team All-American. Nobody threw at him last year. He only had 23 opportunities to knock the ball down. Yeah, exactly. Dante Hightower, the guy that the Steelers might get. Keep in mind, one of the best defenses in college football history, he was the captain.
Yeah.
He was the ringleader of that team.
Which is the perfect guy for the Steelers. Not only is he a great player, but he's a fantastic leader, and he would fit in so well with the
Steelers. He's a great communicator. First-team All-American, Lombardi, Butkus, and Bednarik finalists. And he had 81 tackles on last season.
I seriously love it so much if he went to the Steelers.
The last guy, Courtney Upshaw, who is the more athletic version of Dante Hightower than the mental version. First-team All-American, All-SEC, same thing for the finalist awards. 8.5 sacks and 11 hurries on last season. And 38% of his tackles were behind the line of scrimmage. That's going to be an invaluable asset. Just having a linebacker for whatever team he ends up on, that's going to be great. And I think what I'm getting to is, with the Nick Saban effect is, these guys are all going to the first round. Some of the later round guys are going to get a little help just because they got coached by Nick Saban.
Yeah.
Guys like Daquan Menzi, who was Drake Kirkpatrick's counterpart last year, Josh Chapman, the big boy nose tackle down low, who played 8 games last year with a torn ACL. I don't know how you do that. He played 8 of them, the last 8 games, with a torn ACL. And William Vallejos, the center, on the team last year, he will get a boost, and he could get drafted in the late rounds if that ends up being an important factor, that he was coached by the Sabatron.
The Sabatron, which is a new nickname that Nick has just coined.
I did not just coin that.
Okay, I know.
All that got me a little excited about college
football. It's a little exciting. College football is coming.
It is around the corner. It's already a news item, as the college football talks are underway, talking about refurbishing the BCS postseason into something that fans aren't going to kick and scream about this season. Josh, are you in favor of a revolution?
Yes.
In the BCS postseason selection?
I sure am, Nick. I would love the playoffs. The question is, how many teams do you let in? We had this discussion. Was it two casts ago?
I think so.
Whatever. It was the worst podcast we've ever had, by the way. But
just on formatting and attention level,
we're all just yelling random stuff. But we had a discussion about this. How many teams do you let in before it turns from the elite teams to letting some of the middle of the road teams in and stuff like that? And we have a couple scenarios that have been passed around by commissioners of various leagues and stuff.
Well, I think the important thing, as you were saying, is you want to get it so it's between getting who are clearly the best teams on the season, but you don't want to stretch it too far.
Exactly.
And you want to get as many people as you deem appropriate for shots at having a great season and a national championship.
Yeah.
You don't want to go as far as the NCAA tournament has gone. And granted, the field of 64 is fantastic.
So exciting, but
it's
the
so
best
exciting.
Teams so rarely
but there's
win.
So there's so many teams that don't deserve to really make it. You
exactly.
know, those guys that get snubbed when really they didn't have a season worthy of having a chance of winning the national championship. Some of those teams that get in, you're just not sure. I think a lot of college football has always been placing a lot of value on the regular season, and I think you need to keep that because it makes every week so exciting. And that's something college football has over college basketball, is every week in college football
is a
big,
huge,
important
game.
Week.
Yeah.
And unlike college basketball, where people can just casually tune in March and have a great experience. But with that said, yes, there are a few postseason options. There are some that I'm very okay with. There are some that I'm not quite okay with. But, you know, that's part of it. I think they're going to go with the one that's closest to the system they have now that still appeases to a lot of people. I don't know. There's a few. I'm personally in favor of the +1 format, where you play the games and then the best team plays at a different, the best two teams play at a different site.
Yeah.
I'm obviously a fan of that because Nick Saban is a fan of that, and I will
follow
that man to the ends of the earth. Also, a four-team playoff with BCS rankings is something that I'm okay with. I think the BCS does a very fair job of evaluating which teams I think they do a great job with the rankings. It's just the fact that the postseason is what it is that makes people so mad. So you wouldn't have a problem with ranking Alabama over Oklahoma State if all
four teams got to go into
the postseason. That's where the issue lies. So I think the BCS does a great job ranking it. And there's two other ways you could do it, in my opinion. Eight teams.
The eight team is the one that I
like the eight teams. I like it doing it by BCS rankings, regardless of conference championship.
That's what I like the best.
Too. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 going in. So if there are two teams, or three teams in this case, in the SEC that deserve a shot at the national championship, all three of those teams get to go. But if you don't like that, then you could also do it by six teams being their conference champions. So in this case, we drew it up a little bit. That would be LSU of the SEC, Wisconsin in the Big Ten, Oklahoma State in the Big 12, Clemson, ACC, West Virginia in the Big East, Oregon, and Oregon in the Pac-12. Then on top of that, the seventh spot goes to the best conference champion that isn't in a BCS conference. This year, it would have been Texas Christian. And then one catch-all wild card. Obviously, that this year it would have been Alabama, because they were the best non-conference champion in college football. I like that system a lot.
I like that one a lot too, and I've been thinking about it for the past couple hours. And I always complain about in sports the division winners, like in professional sports, the division winners getting preferential treatment over seeding and stuff. But I don't. There's something about each conference having a representative that I just like. Because I don't really think it's the same thing as the division winners. It's really hard for me to decide between those two. Because I like the diversity of all the conferences being represented, but at the same time, really, West Virginia is so bad. Clemson lost by like 50 to a terrible team. Those teams really don't deserve.
The thing is, I don't think you have to order them. For example, Alabama, because of the wild card, doesn't mean they have to be the
eight. Do those two teams deserve to have a shot for the national championship?
You could go by, I'd say Clemson almost had a shot about for the national
championship. Clemson was good all year. They kind of fell apart at the end.
They lost a couple games. But
the Big East is just usually bad,
though. Yeah. I personally don't think the Big East deserves to be a BCS conference anymore. It's where the money is.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's also where basketball is, so there's that. But, looking at these teams, you would obviously put them in a seeding order that is similar to the BCS rankings, or as close as you can get, and you would have at it like that. So LSU and Alabama would be the 1-2 seeds, respectively. And you could still get a matchup that would be the two best teams in the country, but they'd have to fight their way to get there. And that would obviously take place over a bowl season. You might get some better games, because when those teams get those weeks off, they tend to get a little rusty.
Exactly.
And certain teams don't perform the
way
they should.
Which is why the national championship game is usually a big buzzkill for me.
Yeah. And there's also the four-team BCS format, which is just the top four teams playing two semifinal matchups and then a final somewhere else, rotating between the four big bowl locations, and you do those by BCS rankings. That would have been something that a lot of people would have liked to see last year. Obviously, an LSU-Stanford matchup, not as favorable at least, as Alabama-Oklahoma State.
No,
who would have paid money to go see that game?
I would have paid a lot of money to go I would have paid money.
The top offense in the nation versus the top defense in the nation.
On paper, a beautiful game. Maybe it doesn't turn out to be that way, because I think Alabama probably would have won.
I think Alabama would have won.
But I think it would have been a better game than the LSU.
Because
Alabama,
if you look at the weaker, you're only as strong as your weakest link.
Exactly.
And if you look at the weaker side of both of those teams, Alabama had like the 22nd best offense. Against some pretty good defenses, and Oklahoma State had a pretty, like, 110th best defense.
Yeah, their defense
was against some good offenses, but it was not a good offense, or not a good defense.
They had their moments, but overall, not a very good defense.
Also, the other option is four teams conference championships. I don't know how I feel about that, because looking at the matchups, it's between LSU, Wisconsin, Oklahoma State, and Oregon. Some good teams. I don't know if Wisconsin deserves to be in there. Granted that they are only were only out of the national championship
because
off of two Hail Marys.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess it's an okay thing, but if you're I think you're taking a lot of value away from other conferences. Like, say your conference is a really good conference, and you get snubbed because the Big East conference champion gets to go instead of you. That's not something you want to see in college football, because it makes for worse games.
Yeah. Of the possibilities, that is the one I like the least.
Yeah, I don't like this 4+1 format. I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
Where they're trying to preserve the integrity of the Rose Bowl, while at the same time make a playoff kind of format.
Yeah, that's just... If they're going to do the playoffs, they need to... It's going to be the end of the Rose Bowl and stuff like that. Tradition is great, but if they do a playoff, it's going to be a completely different... You can't have the Rose Bowl and the playoff.
In this case, you cannot have your cake and eat it, too.
I think if we're going to rank these in terms of which ones I like the most, I would say the 8-team conference champions would be my favorite. Then the other 8-team one with just the top 8 BCS, and then the 4-team BCS ones. I don't know. I like the conference championships all getting to play.
I truly like the way the BCS ranks college football teams.
I do too. It's a tough call for me there, because I always think that the best teams should get to play for the championship.
Yep.
But there's something that's just college football is different to me than professional sports. Obviously, it is. That's an easy point to
make.
But I just think the diverse, I don't know. I don't even know how to argue for it. I just like it.
I mean, how else do you rank teams in sports like college basketball with only 12 games to go off of? You really can't. And it's always going to be someone's opinion. In this case, Associated Press writers. Certain the distinguished BCS voters. Guys like that. And I think everyone gets mad that, it's the voters that are deciding the national championship. Well, yes, it is in this case. But I think that there's nothing wrong with the BCS rankings.
There's nothing wrong with the rankings. It's just that,
it's the fact that the rankings end up in a result where they just...
Like, this is what happens.
This
you
is,
just deal
this
with
is
it.
What's happening.
Tough luck if you don't like it.
This is the game. And as an Alabama fan, I will go on record and say, you don't really deserve to be in the national championship if you don't win your division under these guidelines.
Yeah.
I think Oklahoma State had a better shot. Would Alabama beat Oklahoma State? I think yes. I don't think that
you can go either way. I think either way.
Judging off of what we saw in the national championship game, I think the national title should have been Alabama, Oklahoma State.
I totally agree.
And it probably would have been had Alabama won that November 5th matchup. I don't think the situation plays out the same for LSU as it does for Alabama. So, I mean, just going off of that, I don't think Alabama deserved to be in the national championship. Still happy they won, and I'm not saying that it's a asterisk on a season because it was a good season, but I mean, come on. Like,
if you can't win your division,
you under those circumstances, you should not be in the national
But championship. That's why I like the inclusion of the wild card team, because like you said, Alabama by the guidelines doesn't deserve to play, but Alabama
clearly
was the best team in the country.
They were the best team in the country.
Exactly. They totally deserve to be in the game, but based on the guidelines they didn't. I think the thing that you have to decide on if you are a college football fan is, do you want the 8 best teams, or do you want it... man, I don't know.
I'm all about good football, and I want the 8 best teams.
This is a beautiful discussion. Do you want the top 8 teams, regardless of conference, or do you want it to be like a mishmash of the entire country, top teams in each conference? I just don't know. It's something that I'd have to think about for a long time.
I think
it will be a source for great debates in the
I think I want the best 8 teams in the country. If you look at the possible matchups you're seeing out of that, it's think it's LSU.
Did we write down the top 8?
No, we didn't write the top 8. I know Alabama Boise State is a first round matchup. LSU probably playing, I think, Kansas State right off the bat.
I'll look it up from last year.
It's
15.
It's great.
Rankings.
Yeah.
Okay, top 8. It would be LSU versus Kansas State, Alabama versus Boise State, Oklahoma State versus Arkansas, and Stanford versus Oregon.
I like those matches.
Those have been some pretty good games. Who would it be if it was the top 8? Or the that's a lot harder to do off.
It's harder to do off the top, but if you look at it,
it would probably be LSU.
If you look at it like this, we'll put it in order for you. LSU,
West Virginia,
Alabama. It's the second time.
Well, is it? Is the wild card team just the 8th seed, or are we doing it based off?
No, it's based off of
rankings.
So, let's see.
Then Oklahoma State.
Yeah, Oklahoma State.
Oregon.
We're doing this live, folks.
Yeah, this is how we roll on this show.
I think West Virginia would have been the 8th seed.
Yeah, West Virginia wasn't even ranked, I don't think. Wisconsin was 10th. Yeah, Wisconsin would be 4th, I think.
No, Boise State would have been in front of them.
Well, yeah, you're right. I didn't see Boise State.
Okay, so looking at these matchups, LSU versus West Virginia, Alabama versus TCU, great defensive matchup,
yeah.
Oklahoma State versus Wisconsin, and Oregon-Boise State, a very high-scoring affair.
Pretty good games.
You'd get a little bit of everything in that with those games. I like the idea under these circumstances, but I don't know if I want a Big East team to keep, especially with West Virginia moving to Big 12. I don't think they deserve another shot at, you know, a BCS bowl. So I'm glad that they're kind of getting rid of the system so I don't have to watch a Big East ACC matchup again.
This is a difficult conversation to have, though, basing it just off of last year because, I mean, what, 3 years ago, West Virginia was almost in the national championship game. It's hard to base everything off this 1 year. It's just that... I don't know. I mean, maybe next year all the conferences will have great teams. You never know. Wisconsin could be the best team in the country next year, although it's probably not going to happen.
Maybe all the conferences get rid of their football teams.
Exactly. Maybe football will cease to exist and they'll start playing cricket. You never know.
Yep.
I don't think they're going to do that, though.
Speaking of cricket, we are going to talk about the Pacers now.
That is a very good segue.
I thank you. As some of you know, the Pacers...
exist and play basketball.
They fell prey to their division rivals, the Chicago Bulls, tonight. And that at the last game of their regular season, they finished 42-24 on this lockout season. How do you feel about it overall? I know we talked a little bit about this last week, but just kind of now that it's officially over, what are your thoughts on this season?
I am thrilled at how well the season went. I honestly could not have imagined anything better than this. I do this every time we talk about the Pacers, but this season, this Pacers season is so equal to the IU basketball season. Just both of them exceeded my expectations by so much.
You compare these two a lot.
They're the same team, though.
They're not the same.
They're so close to being the same team. Okay, whatever. But I see a lot of similarities. But the point is that the Pacers, I don't even know what I thought was going to happen. I didn't think they were going to be the third team in the conference. I thought maybe they'd be like the 6th seed or something. This just blew my mind that they were this good. It's like everybody improved. And all the veterans who are coming out, like David West, just came off knee surgery. He had a great season. He was a great leader for that team. He provided some great minutes for them, scored points, got rebounds, the whole package. It was just... Frank Vogel brought them all together. I'm just like, I'm so happy with how this season went, and I'm so glad that they're playing the Magic in the first round, because I think they will beat them. What about you? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I really like the season as much of that as it is I didn't get to watch because of our super limited cable package that is provided to us by the Indiana University Residents Association, whatever it is.
yeah, I have no idea what's
going on. I mean, I like the way this team has gelled over the season. They had a lot of off-season acquisitions that I was so, so pleased with, and they've ended up being so good. Obviously, a guy like David West coming in, just scrapping Tyler Hansbrough as your starting power forward and getting a guy that has a lot of veteran experience, a lot of leadership. He made a big statement heading into the early season about we shouldn't be accustomed to losing. We need to expect a win and be upset with losses. And I think that mentality is kind of what turned the season around for them. They were able to go on the road and beat teams like Chicago and the Los Angeles Lakers and the Dallas Mavericks.
They didn't beat on the road.
They didn't beat the Heat on the road.
They almost did, though.
But I'm very impressed with how they played this season. Paul George has stepped it up athletically as a great scorer and a human highlight reel that only flies under the radar of Blake Griffin because of the city that he lives in.
I saw somebody that is a complete non-important person, but he tweeted that Paul George... This is just some guy I saw on Twitter. I don't know who he is, but he compared Paul George to Kobe Bryant when he started to play, when he was a younger player, so... That'll tell you what an impact he's having on
that one man's life.
Yeah, that one guy who I don't know who it is. But the point is, Paul George is athletic, and he is just, the sky is the limit for him. Not the sky, I don't even know, higher than the sky is the limit for him, because he's just so athletic, and that's the best thing about this Pacers team, is that David West is pretty old, but the rest of those guys, the Granger's the oldest, and he's probably 29, 28, something like that, so this is going to be a good team for years to come.
Yeah, I think the only issue I'm seeing so far with this team is the point guard position.
Yeah, Steve Nash.
I don't really want Darren Collison on the Pacers anymore if he expects to be the starting or the backup point guard. Either I want Collison off the team or I don't want George Hill to be the starting point guard.
Yeah.
I want both of those things, actually. I don't think George Hill is up to par with other NBA starting guards at all. I think there are so many teams, there's so many bad teams that have better point guards than the Indiana Pacers do. I mean, like, DJ Augustine is a better starting point guard than George Hill, and he's on the worst team. Kemba Walker, same thing, and they're both on the worst team.
Kemba Walker on the Pacers, that'd be wonderful.
That would be wonderful. They need a big guy.
Yeah.
I love the idea of Steve Nash being a Pacer as much as it won't happen.
It could. I mean,
it could theoretically because they're an unavailable team.
They're an available team and they're a young team and he would be. Like, you put Steve Nash on that team.
I asked people to start movements or start like a potential movement for the Pacers acquiring Steve Nash, and I got some interesting hashtags back that aren't necessarily, you know, fantastic, and we need to brush it up a little bit, but it's not as good as, you know, the Lindiana hashtag that I made
up. Nothing is better than the Lindiana hashtag.
The Lindiana hashtag is pretty great.
What if Jeremy Lin played for the Pacers?
Won't happen. The ones that I saw, one from Tyler Varnell, hashtag Nash 2 Sirs.
Yeah. Which works. I don't know. I can't like it.
Well, another
doesn't really make any sense.
Another one, hashtag Canada is closer to Indy than Phoenix.
It's a really long hashtag.
It's not true for Steve Nash because he's from Vancouver. So I think Phoenix is actually closer than it totally is. And then from Caleb Gardner, hashtag start George Hill, hashtag hometown hero. I don't think he got the idea of the situation.
Yeah. But George Hill is not good enough to be a starter. He's a great backup, but he's not good enough to be a starter.
Guys, Steve Nash has been threading the needle for like 13 years.
We were watching him play the Spurs earlier today, and he made one of the most beautiful passes in the history of sports. Not really, but it was a really good pass. He's a really good player.
He did
deserves
it like
a championship, and the Pacers deserve an NBA championship.
I don't see a better matchup. Other than him going to the Heat and helping out LeBron James and Chris Bosh get a ring.
I think that's what is going to happen.
Two guys that also deserve rings. Look at how good they are. They both deserve
rings. And Chris Bosh was in Toronto for like 6 years.
I think if the Pacers want to win an NBA title, they need to do it without a guy like Steve Nash, because Steve Nash only has 2 or 3 years left. I think I've always been a big proponent or a big fan of getting a guy like Brandon Jennings.
That would be a cool thing to do.
Brandon Jennings, great defensive point guard. He's just He's fantastic. And he's coming from a small market to a slightly larger market. I don't see, granted, if he's a free agent, not a Bird free agent.
He's going to be too expensive, though, I think. I don't know how much salary.
Look how much cap room
the
Pacers
have. I
have
no idea how much cap room they have.
They have lifted all of this crap of still having to pay Jamal Tinsley.
Too soon. They should get Tinsley back.
And if they get rid of Collison, that frees up a little bit more cap room because they paid him like a starting point guard, keep in mind.
That's a good point.
So,
and if they kill Danny Granger, which they shouldn't do.
They're not going to kill Danny Granger.
I don't think they will either, and they shouldn't because that would be mean.
They could theoretically trade him. And
I want them to trade him for Aaron Gordon. I'm sorry. That's what I
want
to happen.
Oh, my goodness. I don't want that at all.
Why would you not want that?
Because
Aaron Gordon is a superstar.
Has spent an entire season under injuries.
Yeah, but he's so good.
And he's not a superstar.
You know what?
He's about the same caliber as Danny Granger.
He would be a superstar if he came to Indiana. You know what they should do? They should trade Collison and... I don't know. They need to get Eric Gordon. Maybe not trade Danny Granger, but they need to get Eric Gordon. I would like that so much.
Fun fact about Josh Wachtel, he wants all Indiana area people to be
the
Indiana Pacers.
I was actually, I'm not a big fan of the Kawhi Leonard.
I do hear that he wants, and now who's the funny guy? Because
I don't think George Hill is a bad
A win-win situation for both teams.
Yeah.
I don't think Leonard works out with the Pacers. I don't think Hill works out.
That's
win-win
discussion.
I think Josh told me the other day in a text that he wants Greg Oden to come play for the Pacers.
I did tweet at our very own Hoosier Hipsteria Twitter, which now exists, by the way, that I wanted Verdell Jones to be the new point guard for the Pacers. Obviously,
he was completely serious.
I was serious 100% because I think he could be the best point guard. Maybe
he also wants DJ White to replace David West.
I want DJ White to replace Roy Hibbert.
And
actually,
he wants Michael Conley and George Hill as the starting point guard.
Okay, Mike Conley would be an awesome get to the Pacers.
No, I'm adding that so people
he would
believe
rule.
Me. I'm adding that fact so people believe you. Also, Jared Jeffries.
Okay, Jared Jeffries, clearly the best player in NBA history.
Can the Pacers try to get a starting five of just all people from Indiana?
They need to draft Watt for next year.
Well, clearly...
No, they need to draft... Okay.
Think about it. Think about it.
Cody Zeller.
Think about it.
That would never happen, but still, it'd be awesome.
Conley, as your starting point guard. Hill as your backup. Eric Gordon as a shooting guard. Small forward to later be determined.
Yeah.
Power forward, Zach Randolph, center... Eric Gordon, or not Eric Gordon, Greg Oden, a healthy Greg Oden.
A healthy Greg Oden? That would be a remarkable team.
Be a remarkable team.
You're going to make fun of me.
Yes,
I am. It depends on how much Greg Oden would make. But, I don't know, just get him, pay him the league minimum, just say, if he gets healthy, he would be so good. But he's not going to get healthy, so it's a moot point. But I think
also don't
cool
want an ogre sitting
Pacers
in
the game.
The bankers. I don't want an ogre sitting in the bankers' life.
Yeah, also Roy Hibbert, so that wouldn't work. But it's just a thing that would be cool if that happened.
In conclusion,
Libby is a land of contrasts.
Yes.
In conclusion, that was a joke, and I don't want them to get all Indiana players. But I do think that Eric Gordon would be a good fit here. I mean, maybe I'm the only one who thinks that, but I'm actually not, because a lot of people have been saying that for a long time.
Here's the wrapped up thought on the Pacers season. And I don't care if we're wrong about this, because I will be just upset at myself. Or not even at myself if they're wrong about this. In conclusion, they will beat the Magic in the first round.
If they don't, I will be sad. Very, very
sad.
No,
Josh, I mean, it's in conclusion.
They almost beat... Oh, that's in conclusion.
Yeah,
that's
it. They're just going to beat him. No Dwight Howard, no chance.
Yeah, no Dwight Howard, no problem. That was a great conclusion.
Yep, and that moves us... Yeah, that brings us right to our segment of Do You Care? Very appropriate, because I don't care about the Dwight Howard being injured.
I hate Dwight Howard. He's my least favorite player in the NBA now.
Yes. Okay, so now we're moving on. I mentioned this earlier. Trent Richardson was contacted by the Jets to get his phone number and a place that they could call him in case something happens and they end up trading up. Keep in mind, they have to trade up 12 spots. I guess this is kind of a do you care, or it's more of a good idea or bad idea.
Well, it depends on who they'd have to give up. I don't know who they would even give up for. Tebow? I'm just kidding. But seriously, I mean, I'm trying to think of who they would give up. I don't think they have a player that they could just give up and they'd be like, yeah, I really want him to be on my team. Because they're a good team. I guess, like, defensively, they somebody. I don't know. I don't really care. Because the Jets, I hate the Jets. I hope the Jets folds the franchise. Rex Ryan becomes a monk or something.
Okay.
I don't know why that would happen. Do you care, Nick?
I care. I want. Well, it'd be kind of nice for Trent Richardson to get started on a pretty good team. And the way they got to the AFC Championship the last 2 years that they did was a ground-and-pound offense.
Yeah,
they had a pretty good running game, and Trent Richardson's going to help any running game become
but
better.
But Sean Green is the best running back in the league.
That's not true at all.
Yeah, it's definitely
that's not true.
True.
That's
it
Alex
cannot
Saff.
Be less
true. Alex Saff, that's not true.
It's just really not true at all.
Moving on, Calvin Johnson has won the playoff for the cover of Madden 13. Josh, do you care?
Yeah, I do care because I love Calvin Johnson, and it's a shame that he's going to be dead in about a month and a half. Because not only is he on the Madden cover, but it's Madden 13. That's just a
so it's
tragedy.
The, so it's
way
the Mega Madden curse?
It's the worst Madden curse in history. But I do want him to be the first one to, like, break the Madden curse and have an outstanding season because he is so much fun to watch. Matt Stafford to Calvin Johnson.
They tried
to
break
so
the Madden curse
watch.
By putting Brett Favre on the cover.
Yeah,
and
then
came
he
out
went
retirement.
To the Jets and became terrible. Even worse. That was so bad.
Yeah, I don't care. And I'll tell you why. Because Madden has been the same game for the past 4 years.
It is a good point. They have made so little difference.
They've made such a little difference that I don't care. And I don't spend my money on the game. So
I have Madden 09 and I'm all set for a lack. I bought it for like $3 at GameStop.
I couldn't care less about. Also, the Colts are going to be bad next year, so I don't want to play with them. I could. Actually, doing a rookie season with Andrew Luck would be kind of cool.
That would be a little bit fun, but also it would be the Colts and they would suck.
The Colts too. Would be really bad. Whatever. I don't care.
I sort of care, but not really.
In the world of baseball tonight, David Wright passed Daryl Strawberry for all time Mets. Leader in RBIs was 735 on a two-shot.
Two-run home run to take the lead and win the game. I care. Yeah, I care a lot because I love David Wright, and it is awesome that he is the... RBI is not a great stat, but still it's awesome that he's the all-time leader because...
It's a great stat.
I love
talking
David
about?
Wright. Well, it's...
It's like assists.
Well, it's not really because it's sort of...
Similar
it's so
assists.
Much... It's so much... It, well, I guess, but... It's so dependent on other people getting in base in front of you. Example.
Tell me about assists.
Justin Upton. That's exactly right.
It's
yeah.
very pertinent to
exactly.
making a shot.
But, yeah, exactly. Like, RBI. Example. Justin Upton. Great hitter. Did not have very many RBIs last year. I don't know.
I don't care.
Point is, I care because I love David Wright.
I don't care.
You don't care because of Matt Herman Kane and his... Being the best right-handed pitcher in the history of baseball.
I'm sorry why I don't care. Just being, like, objectively, I just do not.
Yeah, I understand that you're not caring. I think the only people who care are Mets fans.
I don't care about the Mets record books. David Wright seems like an okay guy.
He's a great guy.
Good for him.
He could be president.
Good for him, but whatever.
Honest, yeah.
Great.
I'm surprised he even included that.
It was on
your screen. Yeah, okay.
The new New Orleans Hornets owner wants to change their name and or image. Do you care?
I don't really understand.
And if okay,
what
they're not going to be the Hornets probably come next season.
Yeah, I don't know.
They're going to change their name.
It'd be weird.
So
when's the last time they weren't?
So,
have they ever not been the Hornets?
No, because they started
in Charlotte.
New Orleans was the Jazz.
They were the
and then
that's
they moved
so
to Utah.
Confusing to me. All the teams moving around. I don't know.
I think
I'm too old for this.
I think what should happen.
They should become the New Orleans Air Gordons.
Utah should lose their Jazz rights and give them back to New Orleans. Utah
what would Utah be? Becomes the Boring
Storm and Mormons?
Yeah, that would be sweet. The Jimmer Fredettes, even though he doesn't play for them.
He would if they were
he would
Jimmer
move,
Fredettes.
He would move and become player, manager, and owner. And every time he shot, he would yell, Jimmer!
Everybody yells Jimmer.
Everyone yells Jimmer. Even Kobe yells Jimmer when he takes a three. It's a little known fact. If you listen closely, you can hear it, though. But no, I don't care, because it's the Hornets, and who cares about the Hornets? Other than Hornets fans, which don't really exist.
I like the idea of...
The whole new
name.
I don't know. I don't really like new names.
The Thunder?
I don't know. I mean, yeah.
Such a cool name.
But the Thunder, like, they should be the Lightning, because Lightning can kill and Thunder can't.
No, but it's the Thunder,
I do
dude.
Like the Thunder. I like the Thunder a lot. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know.
I'm excited about it. I like new names, new
but
uniforms.
But Oklahoma City, that's going on.
Especially when the team's not leaving the city. It's not. They're playing in New Orleans. They're just reformatting their look, and they should, because Hornet. The Hornets has nothing to do with their city's affiliation.
Yeah, I will say I did like when the Diamondbacks changed their color scheme. So I think the Hornets should be able to do whatever they want.
And I think they should try to keep their, you know, their New Orleans color scheme.
I think it'd be one thing if they changed it, if they were the Jazz right now and he was going to change it, because that is New Orleans, but since they're the Hornets and it has no real impact, yeah, they should be whatever they want.
Little known fact,
they should not be the Hurricanes.
The Charlotte Hornets were like the first team to use teal in their NBA uniforms, and that sent a widespread.
So that was their fault?
A lot of. That was such
teal
a good
was
time.
Awesome. Teal was awesome.
Vancouver Grizzlies?
Teal rules. The Diamondbacks used to be purple and teal. It doesn't get more BA than that.
It's great.
It gets
fantastic.
Way more BA.
But speaking
anyway.
Of uniform changes, the Brooklyn Nets, a.k.a. Jay-Z's Brooklyn Nets.
Brooklyn Nets brought to you by Jay-Z.
Brought to you by Sean Carter Jr.
I would call them that one.
They're going to change their logo and color scheme.
Is it going to be a picture of Jay-Z?
I hope so.
The Brooklyn Jays.
There's a picture online of just a black. It's just a black screen with their like shield looking symbol. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
How the Nets are kind of in a shield shape.
Yeah, I got
it's you. Just a white line in the shape of a shield. Hashtag Hello Brooklyn underneath. Lot of hype for these new uniforms in such a big city. Do you care?
I think. Well, I do care because what it should be is that same shield except the white line. Sean Carter doing the Hova sign, and they should be called the Brooklyn Carters.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
The Carters?
The Brooklyn Carters, because actually, I think they should be called the Brooklyn Deckers. It's what a sweet name for a team, and she's hot. So. Okay, but really, no, I don't care.
I
do care, kind of, because New Jersey Mayor Chris Christie was like, oh, good riddance, Nets, and I hate Chris Christie, so. That's
didn't they win a title?
Probably, yeah. No, I don't think.
Like, years back, they totally
Well, but it was
wanted.
Before Jason Kidd was there, because Jason
it
Kidd's
was
first title...
Jason Kidd
Jason
was
Kidd for his first title was
okay,
the Mavericks.
Okay, they were in the finals.
They did go to the finals. I don't think they won, though. Because I'm, like, 99% sure Jason Kidd just won a finals for the first time, like, 2 years ago.
Totally.
Or last year, which is when he won with the Mavericks.
Yep.
So, yeah, no, I don't really care. Whatever.
All right, well, I do. Because
oh,
the same
know.
Reason as last time, I like the idea of...
I
like the idea of the Nets being cool.
Yeah, I do kind of want the Nets to be good. I don't really care about the Nets.
Not good.
I don't
cool.
care about the Nets. Yeah.
Cool.
Well, they're going to be cool because Jay-Z, man.
Exactly.
Except that. And their Russian owner, what did he say? He wanted to, like, kickbox Mark Cuban or something? That is so awesome.
I want them to wear black on black.
The Nets could be cool. Do you want them to have Oregon jerseys? Is that what you're saying?
No, because Jay-Z invented black on black.
Jay-Z. Oh, man. Jay-Z is the coolest guy.
Anyway.
Brooklyn
enough Kanye's. Drooling over Sean Carter Jr.
They should be the Brooklyn Blue Ivy
Carters.
No, they shouldn't. Go ahead.
Subway makes a Robert Griffin III bust out of entirely chicken. Do you care?
The only reason I care is because John Boyes, who writes for SB Nation, wrote a great piece that was just listed, like, I can't even think of the word.
Sandwich puns?
Yeah, puns. And they were all hilarious because they were, like, so bad, but they were so good at the same time. I wish I had the story up so I could read some of them, but I don't, so I'm not going to. But that's the only reason I care.
Alright, yeah, it's creepy.
And I think that sandwich bust might be the third and number one overall pick after Andrew Luck and Robert Griffin III.
Yeah, well, if he's still available when the Raiders pick, then...
The Raiders will take him and make him, like, their new
pick. Actually, the Raiders are doing their first draft in a long time without
Al
Davis, so maybe they will make right picks.
I still think Al Davis has been dead for, like, 15 years.
Rest in peace, Al Davis. Okay, last topic. Spain's... Two big soccer teams fell in the Champions League semis. No, they did not beat each other. Real Madrid lost to Bayern Munich yesterday in the Champions League semi, 3-1. And Lionel Messi continued his Chelsea jinx as Barcelona fell 1-0. Josh, do you care?
I'm not into soccer really yet, although I'm starting to, because I'm a huge Newcastle fan, but they're not involved, so I don't really care.
Oh,
now.
He doesn't care because...
Because Newcastle is not involved, and Newcastle is the greatest.
All right, we'll tweet at Brohan Cruyff and tell him that.
Okay,
also,
I'll tweet at Brohan Cruyff.
Also, I like the idea that for the first time in a while, God loves Spain, I like that for the first time in, I don't know how long, because I haven't been following soccer for too long. I like that there isn't a Spanish team in the Europa League championship.
Yeah.
I like that there's an EPL team and a Bundesliga team. That's kind of cool.
I don't really know the Champions League.
I don't know how I feel about Leo Messi. I know he's good, but I tend to usually not want to see the best player in a sport do really well. And I kind of like that there's a team that has his goat and that he'll eventually get over the hump with this team. But yeah, he hasn't scored on Chelsea yet in his career, and that's kind of a weird, impressive statistic for Chelsea to have. And he totally missed his golden opportunity to do so. And as a result, Bayern Munich will face Chelsea in the Champions League final for the record. Bayern Munich is the first team to go to the Champions League final that it is hosting.
That's weird. It's like if the Colts went to the Super Bowl this year.
Right, let's not talk about that.
Too soon, but yeah. Or the Cowboys went a couple years ago.
Yes.
I don't understand how the Champions League works. Because I thought Newcastle was going to go to the Champions League, but I don't think they did.
They're not good enough.
They were fourth in the Premier League, though.
They're not good enough.
Is it, how many teams from each league make it out?
Probably four, except Newcastle.
But that's not how it works, though. Oh man, I just don't know.
Probably the top four, not including Newcastle.
Okay, but let's all agree, Newcastle could win the championship in any sport.
That's an untruth.
That is the truthiest thing. I just dropped my Sprite bottle. Should we do a product placement now? You want to talk about your Simply Lemonade?
I do not. I would, however, like to talk about a particular music group that has just released their first full-length album.
Led Zeppelin.
No.
The Beatles?
Yes. It is actually Mid-American's self-titled album, Mid-American. Mid-American, a local band out of Westfield, Indiana, is now scattered all across the
globe.
The state, not the globe.
Not the globe. The state.
Between Ball State, IU, Purdue, and one member in New York City.
Who's
at the
New
moment.
York City?
Phil Johnson is
He's
in New
York
City.
City.
He's
Why?
Doing an internship.
For what?
I don't know. Graphic design.
Some friend you are.
Graphic design. But yeah, they just released their first full length this week, and it's really, really good. And I'm not even saying that because
he's a
I'm
fan
their friend.
Boy.
I'm not saying that because I'm their friend. It is objectively a very good album. It's available on iTunes. I would go check it out. It's like not even. It's maybe $8. It's super worth it. It's really good.
Over under 3 Grammys.
At three. At 3 Grammys.
They'll win 3 Grammys.
Yes.
Okay. I have listened to some of it, and it is very good, too, and I am the smartest when it comes to music.
Yes.
I'm not really.
Says Josh walks out to himself.
Yeah. I've never even thought that for a second.
But yeah, that's... I mean, that's kind of the only thing I wanted to plug for our myriad listeners.
We are getting... We're averaging 30-plus viewers on YouTube. I just want to say, we're hitting the big
And we're only, between us, we're only viewing it, like, 25.
I only click on them to see how many views they have, okay?
Yeah, and that
okay.
gives us a few.
Well, you're giving us, like, 30, so.
25.
Okay. And David's, no, actually, David's not doing
in
anything.
In the words of Bubba Sparks, get it right, get it tight.
Okay, Bubba Sparks with, like, 4 X's?
Yes, Bubba Sparks with 4 X's. No, the other Bubba Sparks.
Okay, can we all agree that Dem Franchise Boys, greatest rap group of all time, puts NWA and Run DMC to shame?
Josh, I can't even joke about that.
But it's Dem Franchise Boys, and they spell franchise and boys with Z's.
I can't even joke about DFB being really good.
DFB? You just... Oh, man, I cannot believe you just said that.
I did it because Ruben Green...
What are you drawing?
Just don't worry
simply
about it.
Line. Okay.
We're ending this.
Yeah, this is... This is Josh Wachtel speaking for Nick Wright. Nick Wright? I cannot believe I just said that. Nick Wright.
I'm going to take this over because you're being an idiot.
You know what? You take it over.
Nick Wright. That is the end of our show. We're going to talk this later this week about the and by the later this week, I mean next week, about the NFL draft. Just a recap and reactions to which players our specific teams picked, and any draft surprises that may have happened that you probably already know about. Also going to dip into the early season, or the early postseason of the NBA, as well as maybe talking a little bit about college football, because I'm getting way too excited about college football to not talk about it.
Are we all? IU, this is the year for the Hoosiers.
Right, and until next time, for Josh Wachtel, I am Nick Wright saying good night and good luck.